Hi again. You still have energy for the last round? Okay. Let's talk about state management. But I don't want to talk about libraries. I want to talk about principles. Principles are the pieces that make up a pattern. You all know state management, right? And I'm sure if you created a big app, after some time, you really felt that this topic is not easy. So this talk is here to give you some understanding what's lying under these patterns. And my goal is to teach it in a way that you can make up your own understanding out of it. So the main idea of this talk was based on this quote of Richard Feynman. It's like, if you cannot explain something in simple terms, you don't understand it yourself. And I hope I can explain this today in a very easy way. I will have 4 points. I will talk about state, what is state, when to care about state management. I want to talk about several principles, 14. And then I will talk about the meta model, some really abstract approach of state management. I guess you know me already, so I can skip to the next slides. And I will ask you a question. What is state? What do you think? Is the database on the server state? The cookie in the browser? Some items in the memory? Is the background color of a div state? So, state is everything. Anything can be state. It's just depending on when you should care about it and when not. And this is the next step, when to care about state management. And here are some questions that you could ask yourself before you implement some library or some pattern. You could ask yourself, should my state be accessible globally? Are there many different components in my app that need the same state? Shareable state? How long is the lifetime of my state? A few seconds, like an error message, or a few hours? Do I need to cache this state? Do I need to reproduce it? Or, also very important, do I receive this state from remote sources? And what do I mean with remote sources is like HTTP request, IndexedDB, WebSockets, everything that is like remote. And my state management should bundle this information and then provide it to my application. And this is the main part of the whole presentation, principles in state management. I really spent time to come up with some diagrams that explain the problem or the problems in a very simple way. So, I guess there is a mistake in the presentation, but okay. This is the right slide, so I divided it in 4 different topics. State storage. All about how to store the state, state transformation, how to update my state, and how to architect it. And of course, I will start with this topic of storage. So in state storage, I have 4 different principles that I want to talk about. I want to talk about the separate layer of state, that you should store state in one single piece, and why it is a good idea. I will talk about normalization, and all the people that work on SQL databases know what normalization is, right? And then I will talk about state should be serializable. The first principle is state is a separate layer. And if you think about your application, you would never store state directly in your view. You're not able to share it. You have redundant data. So what you do is, and this is a very simple and easy to understand approach, you move this state into a separate layer. And from this layer, you can like easily distribute it. You can reduce the amount of logic, you can share it, and you also reduce the logic. The second principle is one single piece of state. Is there somewhere water? Okay. So state should be stored in one single piece. Why is this important? Because if you start with many different services, you have relations in between the services, and if you have relations, you could easily end up in problems where you have cyclic dependencies and this stuff. So my suggestion is to move all the state of your different services into one single place. You never have to think about relations if you do this, and you will never mess it up. So the outcome here, one single source of truth. This will reduce the amount of data because you are not able to store it redundantly. You will avoid these cyclic dependencies, and it is also very easy to find where is my state stored. And it's easy, it's like in this one single place. Store data normalized is very familiar to the previous one. It means that I should think about how my state is made up. Can I normalize it? If I have a to-do list, I don't store the same name again and again and again and again. I create a table with IDs, ID maps, and then I make a join. And I reuse just the ID, and I don't store redundant data. This not only removes complexity, you could also move the logic that retrieves your state into a separate layer, in a derivation layer. You can also reduce the size of your data that is stored, and of course, it helps you to reduce redundant data. And the last point of storage is store state is serializable. What does it mean to have serializable state, and why is this so important? Did you ever store a function in your store? I know some people that do this, but you will never be able to send this data somewhere else. How could you send this function to a server? It's not possible. How can a server send a function to your client? It's not possible. So it's very important that you think about the serialization of the data that you want to store. Why is this important? This is important because only if your state is serializable, it is consistent. Only if it is serializable, it is reproducible. And this is the only way how you can persist the state. Next step is one direction for data. Why is it good to have one direction? I mean, this is a very well-known diagram. This is from the flux pattern. And they realized very early that you can or you should provide only one direction where your data is flowing. If you don't do this, you will again end up in cyclic calls. It is not predictable at all, and if you compare these diagrams, it's just a mess without this one direction. Now, let's talk about state transformation. In state transformation, I provided four of these rules. State is immutable, functions are pure, you should restrict concurrent state changes, and you should keep your state reproducible. Let's talk about the immutability of state. I'm not sure, but I hope you know that in JavaScript you can only pass references of objects or arrays. And if you pass a reference, you can mutate it. So you have no control which part of your application will change this data or this object or this array. Therefore, it is very important that you provide your state as mutable. Only if your state is immutable, you can have reproducible state. You can have clean state changes, and this is the only way how your state can be consistent. Functions are pure. Why is this important? It's very similar to immutability. If you have an impure function, you cannot reproduce the outcome of this function. A pure function is a function that only relies on the input and produces with the same input always the same output. This is very important. If you keep your functions pure, you have side effect free code. It is very easy to test, way more performant, and you can cache results. Because if your output is directly related to your input, you don't need to run the calculation a second time. If you know that your function is pure and you pass in 2 and 2 and you add them together and the result is 4, you never have to calculate it again. You can just store it in a map, and whenever you receive 2 and 2, you directly return 4. You don't run the calculation. It's called memorization, for example. There are some libraries that help you to implement this. Next part is we should restrict concurrent state changes. Why should you restrict concurrent state changes? On the left side, you see a diagram of a race condition. And on the right side, we see what we should aim. We should aim to avoid race conditions. Why should we avoid this? If we run concurrent state changes, our state is not reproducible. We can also don't provide consistent state because we cannot control how this, in which order it will be changed. And most importantly, if you restrict concurrent state changes, you're able to debug your code. I'm not sure how many of you ever tried to debug the race condition, but it's not the funny part. Let's talk about the reproducibility of state. This diagram shows state changes, the X and the check mark here, they should be flipped. But what I wanted to say is, the upper part is not reproducible. You can never jump from the first state to the second state or back, especially back. But here, it is a very clear way of how you change your state. And if you keep your state reproducible, you can have some cool things that you're now able to implement. For example, only if your state is reproducible, you can implement optimistic updates. You can implement a redo-undo mechanism, or time travel debugging like Redux is famous for. The fourth part is state updates. And in state updates, I will talk about three different principles. I want to talk about push-based architecture, this one direction for your data, and a separate layer for your state derivation. So what is push-based architecture? For me, I would say push-based architecture is the most beneficial concept that you could introduce in your software. On the left side, we have the request response pattern, which is related to an HTTP request, and the client always requests the new data. Server does some work, and then you get the new data in a response. If you switch to a push-based architecture, you just tell your interest. I'm interested in this and that data. And then some inner logic that I call here broker logic is responsible for pushing the updates to you. So you don't need to care when to update, when to pull the new state. You can just say, I'm interested in this and that, and then you wait for updates and they get pushed to you. Why is this so good? Because it is very convenient to use, very convenient to implement. You have data freshness, and you can reduce the complexity of all your state updates. You don't have to pull it again and again and again. And this also reduces your traffic, if you think about HTTP requests, for example. There is the graphic missing that was before, but if you provide one direction for data, you have a predictable data flow. You can avoid loops in your updates, and you have a maintainable architecture, which is also very good if you want to scale your application or if you want to hand it over to other teams. The next thing is state derivation. What is state derivation? State derivation is like inner joins in SQL queries, for example. And in the NGRX library, we call it selectors. What you should do is you should keep your state derivation in a separate layer so you can reuse it, recompose it. If you move this logic into your consumer, into your view, you will not be able to reuse it. You will have a code that is redundant everywhere in your app. This is really not a good approach. Why is this so important? It is very easy to extend. As I said, it keeps your logic dry and reusable, and it reduces the complexity of your code. And the last part is architecture and state management, like really general ideas what you should try to implement. Three things. Encapsulate events into objects, provide events as one source, and the last one, the most important one for me, adopt and maintain state should be simple. What do I mean with encapsulate events into objects? Again, the X and the check mark should be flipped. If you look about this wrong diagram on the bottom, you see that there is a direct connection from the source and the consumer. So it is very tightly coupled. And you're also not able to transport a change or some event somewhere else. The right thing, if you look at the correct diagram at the top, you see that we encapsulated the event into a separated object. And then you can just, for example, fire an event or use streams to trigger these changes, and then many different consumers can just subscribe to it. And you're also able to take this event and send it somewhere else, for example, to another client or another server. So it decouples consumer from receiver. It enables you to scale your application very easily. And this is also some very important part if you want to do server-client communication, like you want to send this event to your server. Then it is, there is no other way than moving it into some serializable, decoupled, encapsulated object. Next is provide events as one source. What do I mean with this? If you look on the right side, it's very confusing. A lot of errors, a lot of directions. Everyone communicates in a different way. And now take a look at the left side. You see that it looks way more organized, and all our different interactors, I call them middlewares, they are sitting in the middle, in between something else. They just fire their events into one single stream, and then our consumers can subscribe to this stream. It's very easy to provide one direction with this pattern, and it's also very good if you want to go push-based the full cycle, if you want that your server sends events to your client, they would also push it into the stream. So what are the benefits if you provide one source for events? One direction is very easy to keep. As I said, you can easily connect remote sources. You can say this and that REST backend pushes the results there, my Firebase will push there, or my other remote sources will just directly connect to this one single stream that I can also subscribe to. And it also reduces a lot of complexity in your code. It makes it more maintainable, more reasonable for you. I will come to the last principle of this presentation, which is for me the most important one. Adopt and maintain state is simple. I'm not sure if you know this formula, but it's the explanation, the mathematical explanation for 1 + 1 = 2. Imagine you have a new software team that starts that don't have had a lot of idea of state management, everyone is new, and you start with a Redux implementation. You have like that steep learning curve. No, we spend a lot of time to explain this stuff. What I would suggest is just take some of these principles that are important for your current solution and start simple. It's easy to understand that you can later on anyway switch to another framework or library if you want, but don't start very complex. What I would suggest is that you should scaffold what you can. You should generate your actions, your reducers, your whatever automatically over schematics. Vitaly did a very good talk about this. You should have blueprints for every implementation, so you should have a structured approach that is documented and that you can provide to other developers. How should I implement this and that, document it, make it reproducible? And of course, start simple. Don't use complex and mighty libraries. Maybe you start with a smaller one and then you can switch later on, or you don't need it anyway. The last part is some general idea of a pattern. All the other slides were principles, and now this is a pattern that you can think of or reference if you work with state management. It looks like that. You have 4 or 5 layers. You have your events. What are events? Events, for example, if we talk about NGRX, these are our actions that get dispatched. And these actions go into the next phase, in the computation phase. What could be computation? Denormalizing state, action splitting, all this stuff that is done before you store your state. Then the next block is the storage. And here you can apply other principles like store state in one single piece, state is serializable, and so on. So you take some of these principles and apply it to this middle block here. The next phase is the derivation phase. In the derivation phase, you think about selectors, for example, how you calculate your state and how you provide it. The last part is the view. How can your view subscribe to state changes? Do you use event-based transportation, stream-based and transportation like NGRX or so on. And this is my meta model that I use when I try to explain state management, when I try to build my own one. If I want to start simple, I always have this in front of my desk and try to orientate with this. Yeah, I guess it is very helpful to have this in mind. And this is more or less the last part of this presentation. I have only two slides left, and this is not related to the presentation. It's related to this conference. So it were four really good days for me, I would say. And I was thinking, okay, how I will leave this conference. And now I know it. I have one slide that says, I'm thankful. This is really what I am. I'm really thankful that I was here, that I met so many nice people. I made new friends and I met old one. And the second part that is in my mind when I believe this is I'm full of love. I woke up every day the last 4 days, either I was super, how to prevent the word drunk? I don't know, but I was tired, let's say I was tired. Yeah. I woke up, I entered this conference room and immediately I was like really healthy and energized. So thanks a lot for your attendance, for participating to this conference, and yeah, thanks for listening.